Good morning. Please go ahead and take your Bibles out to Psalm 46. Psalm 46. You have to forgive me, like many of you, I'm a little bit under the weather today. Just seems like that is the way life is during this period of the year. There was a time, and I don't know, I guess in a not so frequent past or not so recent past, that we didn't frequently imagine that the world was going to end. You know, but now, I mean, you kind of look at Hollywood and how it kind of sets the pace, or at least is sort of a finger to the pulse of our culture, and kind of you learn that really a lot of people are kind of afraid about things right now. Just look at any survey of the movies that are coming out. A lot of the movies that you see come out these days are post-apocalyptic films. These movies that depict mankind's fear of the world ending, that we could screw it up so badly that things get really, really bad, or that the end of the world is so imminent. You think about movies like 28 Weeks Later, or I don't know, The Road, Seeking a Friend for the End of the World, which is kind of on the nose, right? But all these movies depict the end of the world. I was listening to a radio show one time, and there was a preacher on it, and forgive me if I've quoted this before, but it was so impactful to me. Because it was revelatory to really where we are as a society in the Western world. And what happened on this radio podcast or whatever was that was one preacher was talking about fear. And he said that the modern age tells us that God is a thing of the past, right? That God's not really a reality in our minds today. It's a thing of the past. It was something for dark ages and people who lived in that period to cope with things that they didn't understand, the unknown. But now we know, we're enlightened. Now we're woke. Now we know nothing like that exists, right? No God, no ghosts. We're enlightened now. And there's nothing to fear. And then he told this interesting story about this great earthquake that had happened in San Francisco, right? And it was one of the worst. And just to hear all the people and how terrified they were in all the newspapers. We actually had something interestingly similar to that whenever 9/11 happened, right? Everyone was voicing their fears and they were terrified. And he was listening to Nightline and a question came up. And they said, why are earthquakes more traumatic today to modern people, more so than those of 200 or 300 years ago? And the psychiatrist on the show said, 200 to 300 years ago, they weren't as afraid because people knew that they didn't understand everything, and they felt small, like small people in the hands of God. And today, we don't feel like that. Today, we feel in control. We feel like masters of the universe. And we are more terrified, therefore, more traumatized by anything that reminds us that we are not in charge. And that is the case. You see it with all of the films that are coming out. We are scared, shaking in our boots. The point of my devotion talk this morning, as we prepare our minds for worship to God, for Bible study, for communion one with another, is the key to being composed, to being courageous and strangely level-headed people no matter what the world throws at you. And I do mean strangely. I mean in a way that it looks weird. To be strangely composed and level-headed is about doggedly reclaiming faith in God and insisting that He is with us, that we are not alone. Whenever we become people like that, I think we get closer to our forebears in the Bible, people who are real individuals of faith. And I think we need to recapture that despite living in the Western world where rationalism completely reigns supreme, often in a false dichotomy against that of faith, right? We need to be people of faith. And in order to do that, we're going to look at Psalm 46. Now, this is going to be page, for those of you who are looking in your pew Bible, this is going to be page 471. But before we jump into actually reading the psalm there, slowly, methodically, you guys know that there's just a little bit of a backdrop that we have to consider as we jump into the psalm. That the Psalter is not just a book of 150 individual songs that are to be studied upon their own merit, which it is, but also the book of Psalms was composed and edited by a Hebrew editor, right? They were placed in their certain positions for a reason. And so the Psalms can also be read as a book with 150 chapters, read sequentially, telling a greater story. And if you read this in context, what you come to realize is that in Psalm 44, two psalms prior to this, we have Israel voicing its prayers to God, and they're in a sense freaking out. I mean, they're scared, they're worried, they're saying, God, we've been faithful to you, we've not lied, we've not sinned, and yet our enemies are killing us all the day long. Psalm 45, then, as we transfer in the picture, Psalm 45 depicts the Messiah, the king that God always promised to give peace. And it's this king that leads us to the great city, Jerusalem. And then in Psalm 46, we have this dogged cry of faith in the face of all of our enemies and the things that would threaten to destroy us. And whenever you read it in that way, what you come to realize is that Psalm 46 is this stubborn prayer and cry to God in the face of everything that assails us. And it's in that spirit that we begin to read Psalm 46, and in verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice and the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to break this up into three parts. And we know that this psalm can be taken that way because if you notice at the end of verse 3, at the end of verse 7, at the end of verse 11, there's that Selah, right? And a lot of commentators are debating as to what this exactly means. Some say it's a musical notation, but many are settled on the idea that this is some sort of pause in the psalm with which we are supposed to meditate on what just came before, right? So we're going to break it up based on those Selahs there in the text. And here's what we find. The things that assail us, that we're supposed to stand against with this stubborn, dogged faith, are number one, natural disasters, number two, enemies, and number three, war, all right? So let's go ahead and begin with natural disasters. Now, for this segment, we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 3 in Psalm 46. And notice that there's this great thesis that defines the rest of what comes forward in this psalm. And that thesis is in verse 1. If you look in your Bible there, verse 1, what it says is that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. And it's from that that everything else the psalmist says flows. And so what he begins to do in verses 1 through 3 is develop this contrast. God is this solid, mighty fortress that we can lean upon, that we can have faith in. And he's contrasted to what? Notice that the psalmist depicts the mountains falling into the earth and the raging seas roaring, right? And it's interesting, I was reading a commentary, and you would never know this as an American reading these very ancient psalms, but according to the ancient Near Eastern understanding of the universe, the mountains were almost seen as like these pillars, right? That the mountains were the foundation to both anchor the dry land in the water, and it also held up the sky. And so the worst possible thing that could happen is if those pillars begin to tremble and shake, right? Because the dry land would come up and then the sky would fall. This is the closest the psalmist can get to basically saying the world is ending. Our God is a mighty fortress against this concept that the world could even collapse in upon itself. I'm going to tell you, you can only imagine how many people have felt exactly that same way. When you think about the tornadoes that happen around us, further away from the hurricanes that we read about, Charlotte, different things like that, the Houston flood, tsunamis all throughout the world, that the death tolls reach the sky. I mean, but though our world seems so infirm, the psalmist said, though our world can shake and tremble like this, God is firm. That's what he's saying. I recently read another book by C.S. Lewis. It's almost like every year I read a couple books by him, right? And the book that I read this time was called The Great Divorce. Have you guys heard of this book? It's kind of a fantasy. And what it does is it depicts this narrator, who might as well be C.S. Lewis himself, and he's allowed to leave hell with a group of people on a bus to tour heaven, right? And it's sort of Lewis's depiction in a fantasy, in a dream, of what heaven must be like. And what's interesting, and not without biblical precedent, I would say, is that Lewis depicts heaven as not being something that's airy and ethereal and something that you can't grasp. It's not something that's vaporous. Lewis, in his fantasy, imagines heaven, with biblical precedent, as something that's more physical, as something that is more solid than we can even imagine. And so these people who are allowed for a time to come to heaven from hell, they're ghost-like, they're vaporous. And all these people in heaven are huge, right? And it's so solid that Lewis gives us this image of, if it were to even rain, the very drops of water would tear through your body like a spray of bullets. That's how physical it is. And it's a brilliant image because that's how God is. Right, God is that physical, right? Though everything in our world, like mountains, would seem like they're there for ages, even if they shake, God will not shake. It reminds me of what the Hebrew author wrote in Hebrews chapter 12. If you want to turn there in your Bibles with me, you're more than welcome to. We're going to read a little bit from there. But Hebrews chapter 12 says this, beginning in verse 26. Hebrews 12, verse 26. It says, at that time, his voice shook the earth. But now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. And this phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of the things that are shaken, that is, things that have been made, in order that the things that cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. That's the kind of physicality we're imagining here with our God. All right, so let's move on now in the text to verses 4 through 7 as we consider now our enemies, all right? So look in your Bibles there, verses 4 through 7. And this section makes the timing of the psalm actually truly remarkable because it hints add a historical context for the psalm. In other words, a backstory, right? As we talked about last time I preached on the Psalms, that most psalms have a backstory for why they were written, right? And if you're like me, you'll probably want to scrawl this into the margins of your Bible, but most likely the historical background, the story in the Bible that this psalm corresponds to is 2 Kings 18 and 19. And that's an interesting thing, because when you read that story in tandem with this song that came from those instances, you recognize just what an anthem of faith this psalm really is. Now, here's what we learn. Look at verse 4. Let me read that one more time. Verse 4 says, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. And that's kind of weird, right? It speaks of the city of God. Now, what's the city of God? Now, in a metaphorical sense, we know that that's heaven, that's Zion. But Zion was a hill in Jerusalem. So Jerusalem is the city of God. But here's the weird thing. For those of you who have been to Jerusalem, and I went earlier this year, what you know is that Jerusalem doesn't have a river. There is no river in Jerusalem. But what Jerusalem does have is the Shiloah, or the pool of Siloam. And the Bible tells us that Hezekiah, the great King Hezekiah, after the heart of David, he built the pool of Siloam in 2 Kings 20 and verse 20, among many other passages. And it was during his reign, King Hezekiah's reign, that the Assyrian Empire came down to besiege this city, right? Now Assyria, they proceeded immediately before Babylon. They were some bad dudes, okay? Like, they made ISIS look like Chuck E. Cheese. That's how bad they were. They were super bad. And if they were to besiege Jerusalem, this city, and they would close their gates and protect themselves, it could be a very dangerous thing for the people living within. And the reason why is that it would cut you off from all your food supply. I mean, if you read the annals of history, whenever Assyria came down on a city, People committed widespread cannibalism just to stay alive within the city because they were cut off from their resources. It was super dangerous. So what happens is that Hezekiah is a smart guy, and he recognizes, look, we're going to need a water source if they're going to come down and besiege us. Speaking of water source, let me grab a drink of water real quick. Anyway, so to protect your water source, Hezekiah constructs a sort of underground aqueduct that leads from the Gihon Spring into the city. And interestingly, we were allowed to walk what is called Hezekiah's Tunnel in Jerusalem. Now, what you see here is this little model of that depicts, in general, what Hezekiah's tunnel is. This is an underground tunnel in Jerusalem. And what's interesting is that if you read the stats about it, it's 583 yards. Okay. Now, to put in perspective for you, that's almost 5 football fields, I think. Okay. Don't quote me on that. And what's interesting even more than that is that there is a 12-inch altitude between point A at the Gihon Spring and point B leading to the Pool of Siloam, okay, within the city of Jerusalem. A 12-inch, that's 1 foot altitude difference. These people, these ancients were not dumb. They were not stupid people. They're a lot smarter than a lot of us, right? I mean, imagine the kind of engineering that would have been involved to make sure that was a sort of decline that the water could flow into the city. Now, I'll just show you a few extra pics. You guys probably recognize that bald spot there, right? There's my friend Caleb. This is us descending into the tunnel, right? You guys probably recognize them. That's JR and Sue over at Danville. They were actually behind me. And when we got to walk through here, there's me and my girly stems walking through. We had this rushing water, right? And I had to wear those girly-looking sandals there to make sure that the water didn't just blow my sandals downstream. But the water was roaring. It was super cold. At some points, I mean, it went up to your waist. So naturally, me being kind of afraid of water, I was a little scared. But this is kind of what the tunnel looks like over in Jerusalem, Hezekiah's tunnel that he had built all those years ago. And what's funny is that I actually emailed Barry, who was our tour guide, Barry Britnell, and I said, Barry, after he had told us we were going to walk this tunnel, I said, Barry, there's no chance that this tunnel, I mean, it's an ancient tunnel, right? There's no chance this tunnel is going to cave in and we're going to be like people at the bottom of the Titanic and just drown, right? Like, that's not going to happen, right? And, you know, naturally he laughed at me, but, you know, I kind of have fears myself with water. But I said, there's no chance of us drowning there. And what's interesting is that what made me afraid, verse 4 tells us, made the city of God glad. It made them glad that they had that, right? It's one of the many things Hezekiah did to prepare for the siege of God's enemies taking over that city. And so verse 4 is kind of a clue as to the historical background of what they were dealing with. So here's the reason why I point that out. I want you to see Psalm 46 as Hezekiah's anthem of faith whenever he was dealing with God's enemies, the Assyrian army coming down to fight them. When you read it in that context, it shows this remarkable confidence of Hezekiah, of his faith. I mean, Assyria, like I said, they're bad dudes. These people flayed their enemies. They were known to impale their enemies all around the city in order to cause fear among these people. They were a cruel and powerful empire. The Bible tells us they actually came down to taunt Jerusalem. And when they came down there was a messenger crying outside of the city. And they said, what are you trusting in? In Yahweh? Will he be able to deliver you like all the gods of all the cities that we've defeated? He's not going to deliver you any more than they did. You know what your Yahweh actually told me? Yahweh told me to come and besiege you. You trusting in Hezekiah? Don't trust in him. He'll get you killed. So they're taunting God's city. Naturally, Hezekiah is afraid. And so we read in Isaiah 37, yet another parallel to this passage, that when Hezekiah receives this threatening letter from Assyria, it says that he spreads it open before God, and he begins to pray in the temple about this letter that he's received. And he asks God to help him. And when you read God's reply through the mouth of Isaiah to Hezekiah in Isaiah chapter 37, in verse 26, God says something astounding. He says, this is what I want you to say concerning Assyria. Don't you know that from long ago I ordained this to happen? Don't you know, Assyria, that all these towns that you are sieging and destroying, don't you know that that only happens because I, God the Lord, give you the power to do so? And then he tells Hezekiah in verses 33 through 35 in Isaiah 37, therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he will not come to this city or shoot an arrow there. He will not come before it with a shield or throw up a siege ramp against it. By the way that he came, by the same way he will return, and he will not come to this city, declares the Lord. For I will defend this city and save it for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. It's phenomenal. And with this confidence, I'm going to turn over and look at 2 Chronicles 32. With this confidence, here's what King Hezekiah, even in the midst of all of his fear, here's what he tells his city. Here's what he says after he receives this oracle from God through the mouth of Isaiah. Chapter 32, beginning in verse 7. Hezekiah spoke encouragingly to his people and said, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or dismayed before the king of Assyria and all the horde that is with him. For there are more with us than with them. With him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles. And the people took confidence from the words of Hezekiah, king of Judah. There are more with us. And do you know what God did historically? Was this just all fluff? Was this just random, you know, feel goods that came from the sentimental mouth of our God? No. It says the very next day, while the army of Assyria was encamped around Jerusalem and they were asleep, an angel of the Lord went out, possibly in a plague, and 185,000 Assyrians fell by night. And the messenger from Assyria was allowed to go back to his home with his tail tucked between his legs because he tried to go against the Lord our God. And so it's with that in mind that I ask you, shall then the church, these are the songs of the church, Psalm 46 is a song of the church, shall then the church fear the enemies of God today? There's a lot to be afraid of, amen? You think about ISIS, right? Shall we fear ISIS? All of these church shootings? No, they need to fear, for contextually they're as flabby and misty as the mountains and the seas. Did you notice in verse 46, or chapter 46, did you notice that it's actually the environment that is falling and swaying that's actually compared to the enemies? That there's a parallel here. Compare verse 3, that says the waters roar and foam and the mountains tremble. Compare to the verse 6, what's now roaring and what's now trembling? It says the nations roar, the nations rage, and the kingdoms, they're tottering. Our enemies are just as flabby as the mountains. Listen to me. When we talk about apologetics, we talk about evidences for the faith, and we live in America, and we adopt the Enlightenment views that spirituality is something that's not really palpable, it's not real. There's this tendency to begin to drop in your faith towards God. And it's no wonder why, whenever you think about people in the church, how many people can you count that sound like a Hezekiah? How many people do you know that lead like a David? How many people do you know that sacrifice like an Isaiah? How many people do you know that even remotely resemble anyone from Hebrews 11 in the Hall of Faith? Brothers and sisters, we are a faithless people. And when you look at the dogged faith of something like Psalm 46, what you begin to realize is that it's this almost headstrong, stubborn, in spite of not having perfect evidence, you just cling to God in the midst of all of those things. And whenever you realize, you compare that hope in God against the environment, it looks positively mental. It looks crazy. But it's this rebellious and stubborn clinching of God and refusing to let go, hoping against hope because you think your God is worthy of that kind of faith. That's what he's calling us to. And then, finally, point number 3, we see God's power even over wars. This time we're going to focus on verses 8 through 11 here in your text. So please feel free to look at that text there real quick. Now look at verse 8. It says there in Psalm 46, verse 8, come behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. You know, we want to look at the mountains, we want to look at the enemies, but look at what God has done. It reminds us of what God told Assyria when he said, "Don't you know I planned this from times past? I am the one ultimately in control," he says there. God is the one who's ruling. Is our God that big? Is our concept of God that big? That he's the one who sits on the throne, that one day he will judge. And as Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 4 says, in that very famous passage, that Isaiah 2 and verse 4 will result from God's hand, that he shall judge between the nations, he shall decide disputes for many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. And nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. When you understand all of that, it begins to make sense of the single application we have from this psalm. This psalm has been theoretical in the most part. It's given you a picture of God to increase your faith, but it doesn't leave you without something to do. In verse 10, here's probably the most famous verse from that psalm. "Be still and know that I am God." What does that mean, really? Besides, you know, pasting it on the back of our car or on a wall or something, what does that actually mean in its context? Because this is the key to being concrete in crisis. It's the one application from the psalm. It's what Hezekiah did. Robert Alter shows us that to be still means to relax. That the words literally mean the idea of clenching your fist like this and doing this number. Just letting go. That's what it literally means. It means to relax one's tight and sweaty grip. That one day God is going to make wars to cease. And whenever he resounds in that thunderous cry, "Peace, be still," all the hands will drop to the side and the swords will clashing will fall from everyone's grip to the ground. And so on the one hand, it means that one day God will command it all to end. Everything that you're worried about, it will end one day. But on the other hand, for your individual application, what it means is this, is that in the midst of all of your worrying, in the midst of all of your stress, your anxiety, that thing that you have to do for your aging parents, right, in caring for them, the health complications that enter into our life, the school shootings, the shootings that happen in churches, all of these things that worry us and stress us out and cause anxiety and fear, it means let go. Be still. Be still. Stop your struggle. It reminds me of what Martin Luther would tell his confidant, Philip Melanchthon, right? Philip Melanchthon was sort of this neurotic fellow. And he would be so stressed and anxiety-ridden, kind of like moi. And Martin Luther would say, "Cease ruling the world, Philip. Stop. Just let go." And I'm going to tell you something, man. God forbid, I think I'm going to die from a heart attack at like 43 or something, right? Because, I mean, I am just assailed with stress all the time. I mean, God forbid. But, I mean, I hold on to all of these things. And I'm going to tell you something that helps me when I remember it, something that helps me to finally just let go and to be joyful and not take it out on my kids and be stressed and anxious all the time. It's just recognizing, Tyler, you're not in control. And you don't have to control everything. Be still and know that I am God. And then what else does he say? He says in verse 10, "I will be exalted among the nations." And not only in that great day, not only in that day, but now, in this devotion, that's why we're here. Because God will be exalted. You know how? This psalm is a living embodiment of how he'll be exalted. This song was composed after this whole issue in 2 Kings 18 and 19 and Hezekiah's struggle. This psalm is about singing the praises of God who does indeed deliver and exalts himself in the face of all peoples, tongues, tribes, and nations. That is how. I read in a book, what this means is that the church, as it praises God with the psalms, the church is prophet and evangelist to the nations, to take on a different mentality, to repent by trusting their present and their future to the reign of God. It is no private sectarian activity. It's public. It's the publication of good news that indeed the Lord our God reigns. Listen to me. These psalms represent praise, and praise is our confidence made audible. It's the sound of our confidence. It's the eruption of our faith. And so, I want to wrap up the psalm this way. So, Martin Luther, you guys know I kind of like him a little bit. He is the famous 16th century reformer, German reformer. And music had a profound influence on Martin Luther all throughout his life. Whenever he was still Catholic, he was often involved in a lot of boys' choirs and would sing. And what's interesting is that our tradition, even today, as Church of Christ people who champion congregational singing, who provide this unique form of worship in an American church where that is all not that frequent, we have a lot to attribute to Martin Luther, because it's against the papists and the Roman church that Martin Luther resurrected the concept of congregational singing. He said, you know, when we look at the Bible, we see people singing. Not just, you know, the Romans who confine it to the choir, right? And the rest of the people sit and watch. All of the people would sing. He resurrected that. Now, he lived during a very troublesome time. Martin Luther could have been martyred. His brothers were certainly being martyred. Plagues would break out in Wittenberg. And while he was going through one of the worst periods of temptation in his life, do you know what psalm he would sing? Because he championed the psalms. Do you know what psalm he would sing? I'll give you one guess. Psalm 46. He would sing this psalm. And he was actually recorded as saying, come, let us sing the 46th psalm and let them do their worst. Right? Like, I love that. Let's sing the 46th psalm and let them do their worst. And it was based on Psalm 46 that he composed a psalm derivative, a song that is based on the psalms. Can you guess what song he wrote that was based on Psalm 46? Does anybody know? It's in our books. Ein feste Burg ist unser Gott. That's what you were going to say, right? It's German for a mighty fortress is our God. So here's what I want to do. I want to invite everyone in this room to stand with me, if you can, if you're able, stand with me, and we're going to sing number 16, which is based on Psalm 46. And I know it's early, and I know there are fewer of us here this morning, but I want to sing it with gusto, okay? I don't want to drop or lag or be slow. We're going to sing A Mighty Fortress based on Psalm 46. Here we go. Do, mi, so, do, a mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Fight, our striving would be losing. Were not the right one on our side, the man of God's own choosing. For ask who that may be, Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same. Yeah. be seated. We'll now have a scripture reading and then be dismissed to our Bible classes. Good morning. Everybody feeling good today? Yeah, not yet. All right. Well, I'm very happy to be back with you after a two-week hiatus. Very thankful for all of the men who covered for me in my absence. I'm very happy to be outside of the house, to be with you, to study God's Word. I was gone, obviously you guys know, being busy bringing in the fourth number to the Jimerson Army. And one of the questions I get a lot, maybe those of you who are among my number who have been bringing in babies into this congregation, got to evangelize somehow, right? Maybe you guys got this question, but I got a weird question, right? I keep getting this question, hey, what's it like having four kids? What's it like? And I truly don't know, but I'll tell you what one guy said. He said, imagine you're drowning and someone hands you a baby. That's almost exactly what it's like, right? More so for Amber than for myself. But everything has been really good. And I have to say, in all seriousness, I'm really thankful for you all. God, bless God's name. We were able to bring in another girl to this family, Lucy Sela. For those of you who know, I'm a kind of a psalm nerd. Her middle name comes from the Psalms, and truly, you guys have all been the hands and feet of Christ towards me and my family throughout this period. We love you all so much. You guys have been so zealous to just help out and pray. Continue to keep Lucy, especially in your prayers. Amber's actually not here today because we're not sure, but she might have caught a cold from one of us because, you know, all of our kids are sick. So sometimes I can be kind of hard on infants, so definitely pray for her. But man, I just want to tell you thank you from the bottom of our heart. Truly, our cup overflows because of you all, our church family, helping us as we brought in the fourth. All right, so a little bit of a story. How many of you guys are familiar with Dante's Inferno? All right, we've heard about that. Dante Alighieri writes this epic poem. And it's a poem in three parts. The first part has to do with hell and his transition to purgatory all the way up to heaven is essentially the picture that we get. But in the first part, we see this in an illustration by Gustave Doré here. Dante's Inferno is all about the story of hell. And what's interesting is that Dante, in his image of hell, he tries to construct this sort of hierarchy of reprehensible sins, right? And so hell, in his mind, is this place that's in the core of the earth, and it's represented by these nine concentric circles of ever-worsening sins. And, you know, obviously the first circle, it's still hell, but the first circle is the least bad sin, and then when you get to the ninth gate of hell, it's like the worst. And you'll be surprised to find out, as I was, what would you imagine would have to be the sin that would get you into the ninth circle? Like, what would have to be the worst thing you could ever do to be the ninth circle of hell? And what's interesting is that for Dante, it was treachery. It was betrayal. That what found you at the ninth concentric circle, the innermost circle of hell, was treachery. And what we're going to talk about is betrayal at a sexual level called adultery in the story that I like to call Saved from Stoning. So I want to talk to you a little bit about this story from a crazy text in the Bible in John chapter 8. So everybody, please be turning in there in the Word of God. We're going to read this together and just walk through it and see what God has to say to us from this text. This is going to be page 894 in your pew Bible, 894. And we'll start reading in verse 2. Once you get there, you'll know why we're starting at such an awkward verse. But verse 2 down to just verse 6 right now. Here we go. John chapter 8, beginning verse 2. It says there, "Now early in the morning, Jesus came again to the temple." So he was in Jerusalem at this time. "And all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman and who had been caught in adultery. And placing her in the midst, they said to him, 'Teacher, this woman has been caught in an act of adultery. Now, in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say?' And this they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground." All right, just stop there. Put your Bibles down if you can. And notice that immediately in the story, we're arrested by the problem. And the problem of the text is the sin that this woman is found in. The Bible tells us that she was caught in adultery, in the very act. And what this probably means is that this woman was some sort of virgin that was betrothed to a certain man. And she's caught sleeping around with a different person, with another. And the reason why that would have been the case in this context is that whenever you think about the penalty of stoning a woman, that only happened to those who were betrothed, about to be married, and they're sleeping with someone else, which in their mind would have been exactly the same as adultery for our marriages today. But notice what it says there. This is the text that they're probably reading from. It's Deuteronomy 22. This is the fifth book of Moses in the law. And beginning of verse 23, it says, "If there is a betrothed virgin and a man meets her in the city and lies with her, then you shall bring them both out to the gate of that city, and you shall stone them to death with stones. The young woman, because she did not cry for help, though she was in the city, and the man, because he violated his neighbor's wife. So you shall purge the evil from your midst." This sin was so heinous in the eyes of God that the only just sentence for it was to take this person, the witnesses to the sin, gathering around her, and pelting large stones at her body until she hemorrhaged, bled forth, and died. And what's interesting, and what I want to point out to you, is that like Dante, in God's hierarchy of sin, which is more important than Dante's, I dare say, in God's hierarchy of sin, adultery is one of the worst. And why? I'll tell you why. Because in God's reckoning, in the most often and the most frequently mentioned sin in the Bible, do you know what it is? The most frequently mentioned sin in the Bible is idolatry. It's turning away from the one and true God to other gods to serve them, to be devoted to anything else above God. Do you know what God compared that most frequently mentioned sin in the Bible to? He didn't choose theft. He could have chose theft. He didn't choose theft. He didn't choose murder. He didn't choose dishonoring your parents. What he chose was adultery. He likened it to adultery. He called it spiritual adultery. It's almost like they forsook me, their husband, to go sleep around under every green tree and with every idol you could imagine. Now, for some, it's hard to feel as strongly about this sin as the Bible does, right? We live in the days of the hookup culture, right? Sex without consequence. Tinder reigns supreme. We have apps for it. Open sexuality now in our world is the most normal thing in the universe. And so you're at best a weirdo for having conservative views on sexuality, and at worst, a deeply backwards, mistaken, closed-minded, even evil person for restricting sexuality or what our culture calls love. You're backwards for doing that. I want to tell you something this morning. The Bible is not weird. The Bible is not evil. It's just that we are so far removed. We are just that far removed from the ethics of the Bible, from biblical thinking, and are that desensitized to what God calls wicked, what God hates. So this is what Jesus is confronted with as he's there in the temple. And so now, as you can imagine, he's kind of in a dilemma, isn't he, right? Because Jesus didn't sin. He lived by the law. So Jesus is in kind of a dilemma. They hope to expose, verse 6 says, to expose Jesus to the crowd as a fraud, to earn him, undermine him in front of all the temple authorities there and all the people. So he's kind of like in this catch-22, right? So on the one hand, stone her, if I stone her, now I'm in trouble with the Roman authorities, because being a puppet, you know, government underneath the Roman authority, the Jews couldn't just execute anybody that they wished. They would be going against the Roman power. They alone have power to execute. So stone her and I'd be going against the Romans. Or don't stone her, and then in the eyes of the Jews, I'm seen as a lawless reprobate, right? So this catch 22. What does Jesus do? He does what he always does. He completely blows our mind with his wisdom. So let's see what happens. Now, the plot begins to thicken as we look into the story, because we see that if we dig beneath the surface just for a moment, if we just scratch the paint a little bit and see what's underneath there, we learn that all is not well in this story. Now, here's how we know that. Though it seems like a simple story on the surface, there's a lot more going on here. See, the devil is in the details. Did you notice in verses 2 through 6 and what we just read there, that the woman is thrown before Jesus, but what crucial figure is missing? The man. That's right, Jim, the man. The man's missing now. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but last time I checked, adultery doesn't happen by one's lonesome. It's something, you know, it takes two to tango, right? There needs to be two people there. And the law required that you stone both the man and the woman. Here's my theory. You want to know what I think is going on in this story? In a deeper sense, I believe that the Pharisees planned and orchestrated this sin. I would go so far as to say that. Yes, I would. And here's three reasons why, really quickly. Number one, it's their MO, okay? This is how the Pharisees operate. We know that it's not beneath them to organize various circumstances to entrap Jesus. We see this in Matthew 22. When they come to him asking him, hey, is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar, right? Hey, here's the resurrection. What are you going to think about it? They're trying to undermine him. Not only that, but these are the same people, mind you, that would go so far as to even pay Judas to betray him into the hands of sinners. So this is totally the mode of operation for the, so this is totally something they would do. Number two, who just happens upon adultery? Is that a fair question? Who just happens upon adultery, if you think about it? The law, if you go back to Deuteronomy 22, stipulated that you had to have multiple witnesses to the sin. And not only that, but their testimonies had to corroborate. They had to agree, right? This was to prevent false allegations that someone couldn't just have someone stone immediately at the drop of a hat. This was God's way of protecting people from false allegations. So, I mean, the evidence required to actually convict someone would be so unlikely that the Pharisees, in all honesty, the Pharisees virtually were required to set this up as a trap. And then finally, number three is that the witnesses, which were the Pharisees here, the witnesses were the first ones to stone the woman. Deuteronomy 13:9, 17:7, Leviticus 24:14 required the witnesses and the accusers to be the very first to carry out the execution, which implies that they were to have no complicity in the sin whatsoever. They had to be clean of it. I mean, why, if you were going to see this woman committing a sin, why not warn her against it? Yet they just happened to be there to witness the sin. No. No, the evidence points to the contrary. They planned this sin. They orchestrated it. This was their doing, and all to entrap the master, Jesus himself. So the rest of the sermon is predicated on two points, which are the two things Jesus has to say, okay? Jesus has something to say to the hypocrites, and Jesus has something to say to the harlot. Let's look at the first one by reading verses 6 through 9, okay? So continue reading John chapter 8 in your own Bibles, beginning in verse 6. So here's what he says to the hypocrites. This they said to test him, that they might bring some charge against him. And Jesus bent down and wrote his finger in the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. And once more he bent down and wrote in the ground. But when they heard what he said, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. So he speaks to the Pharisees first, and what does he say? Notice he doesn't say that she isn't guilty. He doesn't say that the law of Moses is void. He doesn't himself lift a stone against her. Instead, ingeniously, he points it back to them, and he says, let him who is without sin among you be the first to cast the stone at her body. And what Jesus has done in the single sentence is he has awakened their consciences to their own hypocrisy. You think Jesus didn't know that they had orchestrated this sin? Jesus was smarter than that. In the very act of seemingly bringing this sinner to justice, they have sinned. They're complicit. What points to this? Where's the man? Did they bribe him? What about the injustice and disobedience to bring him forth as well? Did they really just happen upon the adultery? Why not warn her against the sin? They were being dishonest and deceitful in their motives in every way. They were hypocrites. And so Jesus, in one fell swoop, says, you are disqualified from rendering this judgment on the woman. And so, the woman is probably bent down in fear, cowering that she's about to die. And then she begins to hear rocks. Can you imagine just hearing rocks fall to the ground near her head as one by one the men walk away, their consciences seared, beginning with the oldest? There's two applications I think we can draw from what happens in this story. Here's the first one. Number one, we have to go against injustice as God's people today, as Jesus' people. I mean, you think about it, the very fact that the man was not present in this, the man who was complicit in adultery, the fact that he wasn't present is a real injustice, very typical of this time period. It reflects this sort of double standard going on here. Women are accused and men go free. Why the double standard? Why, when a girl does something wrong, you know, I'm a father of a son and three daughters. Why when a girl does something wrong, she better stop. But boy, the boy does something wrong. Well, he's all boy, you know. He's just going to get in trouble. That's how boys are, right? I mean, you even have this more serious in other countries. Amber and I were reading a book called Half the Sky, and it's a Pulitzer Prize. It's by the Pulitzer Prize-winning author Nicholas Kristof, writes often for the New York Times. And it's about sex trafficking, and he goes on the scene to all the sex trafficking that's happening in Southeast Asia, for example, Thailand. And what's interesting is how common this double standard is among other countries. For example, in India, just for one quick example, in India, virginity is prized among women. The good women are expected to remain virgins so the men can marry one. But then the men are expected to be very experienced by the time that he's married. Women equal virgins, men sleep around. And this injustice, this double standard, has actually been one contributing factor, a fuel for the fire of prostitution there, because there has to be a class of women to fulfill this desire. You tell me God will not hold those individuals in judgment who live with such injustice. Christians need to be balanced, fair people, and they must counteract the double standards they see in their society everywhere. Here's a second thing that we see. We are never qualified to be harsh judges of our fellow man. Jesus disqualifies them from being harsh judges simply by calling them to look at themselves. He says, whoever's without sin among you, cast the first stone. He called to mind, in simplicity, their own sin. Reminds me of some tactics that Paul used in the book of Romans when he heaps up all these judgments against the pagans and the Gentiles and these idolaters in Romans chapter 1. And just as the Jews are creeping up over his shoulder saying, yeah, Paul, get him, sling, you know, he turns around and says, you too, you sin. You who say that I'm a teacher of the law and a teacher of Gentiles and a light to those who are in darkness, do you steal, right? It's like the great prophet Eric Clapton once said, before you accuse me, take a look at yourself, right? And they were using the law as a weapon to hurt in verse 6. They had these selfish motives. And we often can fall into the same practice where the Bible becomes just this sword in our hand by which to stab other people. And we must check our true motives. We should be very fearful of possessing an unyielding judgment against another. Paul reminds us again in Romans 14 and verse 10. He says, why do you pass judgment on your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. And perhaps the scariest and yet hopeful passage on judgment of all, James 2 and verse 13, for judgment is without mercy. To him who has shown no mercy, mercy triumphs over judgment. So that's what Jesus does to slay these hypocrites there with the sword of his mouth. And then he switches over and he begins speaking to the harlot. What does he say? So begin reading with me in verse 10. So as you notice at the end of verse 9, it says they all left and the woman standing alone before Jesus, right? In verse 10, it says Jesus stood up and said to her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? And she said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more." What does Jesus say to the adulteress? So he's there drawing in the sand. And no, we don't have any clue what he's drawing, so that's not even worth speculating, right? But he's drawing in the sand, and he looks up, and he sees the adulteress is the only one left. And so he's standing, she's standing, in a sense, before the only true and righteous judge of her life. And what does he say? Look at that again in verse 10 and 11. What does he say to her? I mean, she was caught in the very act of adultery, in the very act. Some of us have committed awful and heinous sins, but no one caught us in the act. She was caught in the act. And he says, "Neither do I condemn you." Should blow the mind that Jesus pronounced this judgment, right? Do you grasp that? Imagine the adulteress, when they caught you, you knew the law for stoning. You knew you were a walking dead woman from that point on. In a matter of moments, right? Imagine the shock you would feel from hearing, "I don't condemn you." Scandalous. And it forces one, I believe, in this story, according to John writing it, I believe it forces us to ask the question, why? How is that even possible? Why would Jesus do something like this? How can he actually, while still obeying the law, say, "You're not condemned"? I want to show you something cool, okay? Here's the answer. Turn to the very end of this chapter. I want to show you something cool. Do you know what the very second to last verses of this story? So if you look at John 8 as just like a segment story, I want you to notice how it begins and how it ends, right? So John 8 in verse 58 says this. Jesus claims that he's equal with the Father. And John 8, 58 says this, Jesus said to him, "Truly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Now I want you to think about that, okay? There's something beautiful, something poetic happening here. So the story begins with them wanting to stone this woman. And the story ends with them wanting to stone Jesus. What's the point? By confronting this sin of religious hypocrisy and lies, by Jesus being that courageous lying and standing up to the demonic powers that oppress, Jesus will literally place himself in the firing line himself. In John 8 and verse 58, he'll take her stoning upon himself. He's going to pay the price for not condemning her, for showing her mercy, for standing up against the evil oppressors, and I dare say he'll even be crucified for it. Why can Jesus let her go? Because he is going to bear her condemnation in full himself. He says, in a sense, to the woman, "Yes, you deserve stones raining down upon you. Yes, you deserve spears up in your sides, nails driven through you, thorns falling down on your head for your sin, for your awful betrayal and sin. But I will bear that for you. I will go in your place and take that curse upon mine own head." What's sad is that so many people take this story and use it in a way that actually makes light of sin, right? Oh, well, Jesus said no condemnation. All right, no. Jesus never took sin lightly. On the contrary, look at the cross, right? Think about the cross in your own mind. Look at the mangled Son of God, this piece of meat on a steak. Your sin was so bad that that's what it took God to forgive you. But that's not the end of the message. He saved her for a completely new life, because the other half of this exceedingly balanced message is, go from now on, sin no more. We wrap up with two applications and then a lesson will be yours. The very first one is this. What we see in the story is that the cross is the final solution to sin. There is no other, there is no self-help book. There is no Christian publishing. There is no 10-step program that can get you out of sin. The very best solution to sin is the cross. Notice, and notice the exact phrasing, right? This is the holy word of God. It's phrased in a certain way for a reason. Notice the exact phrasing of the sentence. He says, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more." Notice what he doesn't say. He doesn't say, "Okay, sin no more, and then I won't condemn you." He doesn't say that. He'll say, "First, you sin no more. You give a perfect slate, and then I won't condemn you." He doesn't say that. He says, "I condemn you no more. I condemn you. I do not condemn you. From now on, sin no more." And that order makes all the difference. It's the difference between an obedience that's a joy and an obedience that's a burden. That's the gospel message. The New Testament makes it clear that you do not earn your way to salvation by this perfect obedience. You can't do that. Galatians 2 and verse 21. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, through obedience, then Christ died for no purpose. Meditate on that. If you could earn your way, no reason for Jesus to die at all. Take it with you throughout the week. Chew on it. Paul says in Romans chapter 4 and verse 5 that God justifies, that is, he declares not guilty, he makes righteous the ungodly, not those who can be morally upstanding citizens. You can approach obedience in two ways. Let me tell you. Number one, you can try to be perfect all in your own strength and pursue obedience only to sadly be disappointed and overburdened by your own weakness. You'll grow bitter, hard-hearted, self-righteous. Maybe you blame others for sins that you're secretly guilty about your own self in a psychological sense. Or, two, you can rely on Jesus. You can remember that he is born entirely on the tree, your condemnation for sin, and you're free. And because of the joy of the cross, his and yours, your thankfulness for free grace and the aid of the Holy Spirit and the power of his word, you can step forward in this radical obedience that severs sin at the very root. Temptation will fall away like dross because all you want is him who for your sake died and rose again. The cross ignores the symptoms, which is just mirrored outward disobedience, and cuts straight to the heart from which all disobedience flows. And then finally, so go to Jesus. Do his bidding. Look at this woman. Look at her. She was with Jesus, and she left calling him Lord in verse 11. He's her Lord now, right? She went to Jesus, and she recognized that she needed to do his will and sin no more. And personally, whenever I read this story, whenever I think about what's happening and the implications of Jesus' word, neither do I condemn you, and I begin to understand how free the gift of grace is and really how not free at all it was. I feel ashamed that I don't have a greater relationship with my Savior. I don't know if you feel the same way, but he did everything for me. Why don't I speak to him more often? Why don't I serve him? Why don't I go out and sin no more and help others to do the same? But there's something else I want us to get. Her sin was pretty bad. But the point of the story is that no sin is so far that forgiveness cannot reach us. And this point is very important to me. I'm not just saying that. You know, sometimes when we sit in the pews, we imagine, and preachers do get in the bad habit of this. We just say sort of trite and cliche things that we say all the time. But I really mean this, that you aren't too far for God's grace. And here's why. I mentor and I disciple and I counsel people throughout the week. And I have people, real people who come to me. And if I could, if it wasn't an invasion of privacy, I'd share with you the things that they say, their texts. But they always say something like, you know, there is no hope for me, right? I, whenever I got baptized, that was all a farce, right? Like, God doesn't love me. There's no way that God could love me in the midst of all of the difficult things that I'm enduring, in the midst of my sin, my repeated sin. There's no way that God could love me in all of that, right? Why even come to worship? Why even come praise God? Why partake communion? Why even be a Christian at all? Why even try? God doesn't love me. They say things like that. That's real. And if you feel that way, I want you to know that there is no sin so heinous that Christ cannot bear it on the cross for you, relieve you of that weight, look you in the face and say, neither then do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. That's the Christ that we serve. And if you go back to the beginning of John, remember, read everything in context. You go back to the beginning of John, this story elucidates something that John said about him in John 3 and verse 16 and 17. Because here's what it says. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For, verse 17, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. If you are not a Christian this morning and you want your sins to be born and you want to be saved, that opportunity is available to you as you put on the Lord Jesus Christ in the waters of baptism, as you are enraptured in this body of those who proclaim that he is Lord. If you want to be saved, why don't you come right now while we stand and sing this song for your encouragement.